Fine. So we'll do it without the inside. I'll have it. It's fine. So we're going to move to the third story in the Rabbah story. Is the most famous of them, at least in the English-speaking world, because it is the juggler and the king, the one that the book got named for. Ein Gimel. Right, the juggler and the king, which, if you thought the first one was weird, well, the third one is even weirder, okay? So here's how it goes. It's three lines from the bottom of Ein Gimel Amud Aleph. Amar Rabba. Rabba said, L'didi chazili hormin bar lilit. I saw, or hormiz, right? Hormin, hormiz, different names. If you look at Masorah Shas, it says hormiz. I saw Hormiz, the son of Lilith. Whoever that is, we'll see. Kikarahit akufya dishura demechoza. What was he doing? What's right? He was running. Right? He was running. What's akufya dishura? Yes, very good. Right? He's running along the wall. And what is he doing? Viroit Parsha. Ki Rachev Chiyuta Mitate Velo Yochile. Zimunachada Havamisargen Le Karte Kudunaita Vekaimen Atre Gishre de Rogang, Vishar Mahailahai, Umahailahai, Vinokitre Mazge, the Hamra Vyade, Umorek Mahailahai, Mahailahai, Vilanatva, Nitid Futa Laara. What does that mean? Rami, you're pulling it up in the English, so you tell me what it means. You're writing notes?
Yeah.
How do you do that on a phone, honestly?
Difficulty.
What?
Difficulty.
Yeah. So what is Hormiz doing? He's running along the walls. And he's chasing what? So in some versions it's a susia, he's chasing some animal, let's say a horse or a camel or something. Right? If you look at the Masorah Shas, it says that it's a susia. So he's chasing some sort of animal along the walls. Okay. And then what? He can't catch him, right? He can't catch him. Okay? But then what happened? Zimnochada, hama misargon le karte kudnaiti. What does that mean? Right, he's riding an animal, he's unable to catch him. So once they saddled him with two mules, and they stood him on the two bridges of the river, Rognag. And he jumped from this one to that one, and from this one to that one. And he was holding two cups of wine in his hands, and was pouring from this one to that one. Right, he's juggling while jumping from one side of the wall to the other. He's juggling the bottles of wine. And not, right, velo natva nitifuta la'ara, what does that mean? Not a drop of wine fell to the ground. Va'oto hayom ya'alu shamayim yardu tehomot, have, and that day was stormy, like in the Pasuk, that they mounted up to heavens and they went down to the deeps. Adishamu be'malchuta v'katluhu, until the king heard him and killed him. That's it. Okay? Hormiz bar Lilit, chasing an animal, jumping back and forth, juggling glasses of wine that don't spill, until the king heard him and killed him. Hence the name, the juggler and the king. Okay? So now that you know that Gemara, clearly you all know exactly what just happened and we're done, right? Yes, very good. There's a reason that this one has become the most famous of the stories. So what in the name of whatever is going on, right? This is what everybody wants to know. So, not surprisingly, the Mefarshim divide on whether this is allegorical or not allegorical. So let's start. Who is Hormiz? Okay, so who is Hormiz Bar Lilit? Good. Ritva says, Yesh Amrim Shehu Shade. Possibly one, he is a demon. His mother is the mother of demons, right? Ulitzad Safon Hashedim Niglim Leveada Meod. In the north, demons appear to people all the time. That is his statement of reality, yes. Ritva.
This is the Ritva. Ritva was where?
Spain. And in the north, right, you know how like people talk about, you know how, oh, in the Middle East, there are genies, and, right? So that's basically what it is, right? There are demons running around, you know? I have heard that in the tales of whatever.
Is this, like, Nordic countries? Is this Germany? What is he talking
about? I assume Bavel. I don't know. The Yeshom Rimshu, shame Adam Shayodem Odmasa Shinachizenaim. Alternatively, it is a person who knows about the demons and magic, or at least sleight of hand, very much. That's his two possibilities. That is, by the way, all the Ritva says on this story. That is, the Ritva thinks that is enough to clarify everything that's going on. It might be a demon, or it might not be a demon. Now you know what this story is about. Yes.
What? All you need to know.
That is all you need to know. Okay, good. So what the heck is going on in this story? So, not surprisingly, there are the literalists and the non-literalists here. Who do you want first? Which division of Parshanut do you want first?
I would love to we can do literalists, but I can rip off. He just says that and thinks that the Gemara left it in here and put it in.
Because once he was walking around and he saw a demon jumping around and juggling until the king killed the demon. What else is there to know about this story? What?
Why would you include that in the Gemara?
What do you mean? It's fascinating. It's a very important story to know that if you go north, you might see juggling demons. Juggling demons. What's the? I don't understand the problem, Sean. Yes, that's that. You're the only one who doesn't understand this story. Yeah, very good. Now, look, you want to see someone else who sees this? Look, for example, the Rashbam. Rashbam says, Hormiz, he says, Nun, my father told me it's Hormiz, Shade, it's a demon. Right, Rashbam also, it's a demon. What is the story? And he tells you even the point of this story, if this helps you.
Yeah, at least give a point.
Oh, so look, three lines from the bottom of the Gemara. He says, Kuvidishara al Shane Achoma, he's jumping along the teeth of the wall, right, like the ridges. Vahai uvda lo dietzit kotev shal kodesh baruch hu shemarachem al priyavta v'nerushut la'ilu la'zikan v'gam shalol latzit b'derech yachet. Two very important lessons. One is that God is kind and doesn't let these juggling demons hurt you. And the other is to tell you why you should never go outside alone. Those are the two lessons. That is what the Rashbam thinks you're supposed to learn from this story.
God doesn't let juggling demons hurt humans. Because
right, because you might run into juggling demons.
Because God won't
protect you. What? Well, of course, because that's how we read the story. Because the demon was chasing the person, and he didn't catch him. So instead, he resorted to juggling until he got killed. Right? That's the story for him. What? Yeah, there was someone on the animal, presumably. Maybe not. I have no idea. Okay. Anyways, okay, fine. Yeah. Okay, great. So let's. You want to see a literal one first, besides for the Ritva and the Rashbam? Okay, but at least someone who tries to make sense of it. Okay, fine. So Maharal, not surprisingly, if he's going to take it literally, he's going to at least make sense of it, right? The Maharal, you can always count on to at least explain what's going on. Fine, so that's what he says. He says, Da, kivala varalenu kiyesh nivraim shenivdalim mishara nivraim shein baolam. This story is telling you that there are spiritual beings in this world. Uber lanu gdolat galei ayam. First, it taught you about the great waves, you know, the awesome waves in this world. And then it tells you the greatness of this demon thing called Hermes. It is a spiritual power. And then it'll tell you about these magical animals, the Ra'im. Very good. The Hormiz Ze'eno Shade. It's not a demon. It's Ke'eno Medaber Kan Min HaShadim. But now we're not talking about Shadim here. These are important stories. Aval Hubriya Ruchanit. It's some sort of spiritual being. Ve'eno Mechlam Azikim Min HaBriyot. It doesn't hurt people. Ve'omar She'inyano She'yesh Lo Mihirut Zura Yoter Gadol. What you're supposed to know is he's really fast. Oh, I know who he thinks it is. Oh, it just hit me. I read it last night. I didn't get it. Now I'm saying it out loud, and now I know who he is. Who does he think it is?
Naphtali.
Hermes.
Oh.
The god of speed.
Yeah, that's an interesting one.
Right? He thinks Hermes is whatever the Greeks thought Hermes was. The god of speed.
As I'm
saying it out loud, do I realize why this is the god of why this is a spiritual being who's excessively fast? But I'm sure that's what the Maharal thinks.
That's where he's going. That's actually really interesting theological thing, because that would essentially be saying along those lines, the other non-Jewish pantheon.
So that some of them might be some demons or beings or something like that. They're just not gods. Yeah,
That's actually really fascinating.
I did not realize it until I read it, because yesterday I didn't read it out loud. I was reading it to myself. But now that I'm reading it out loud, and I say Hermes, and I say speed, I'm like, of course, Hermes is messenger god. Right, the god of speed. That makes a lot of sense. Right, okay. V'zeu shekatav deve roi akuf yodeshura. V'davar zemorei mihirudus v'zeu lo yimekabel ma'atekla. That's why he's running along. Right? Can he not catch the rider, or the rider can't catch him? These stories are obviously so easy to understand. One second. Let me check back. Yes, you're right. Sorry. Other way around. The horseman couldn't catch him. Right. That makes more sense. Right. The horseman couldn't catch Hermes. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Hermes. That makes sense. V'chein ma deshaver mehagisa laigisa v'imori kasev alnafal natval arava ota yom avirok gadol v'chazak v'imgozel aval natval. And you have to tell him he's not just fast, he's precise, he's balanced, coordinated, right? You have to know he's able to juggle full glasses of wine on a windy day, right? That's while running fast. Very impressive. And that's why the king killed him. And that's why the king was threatened by him, so he had to kill him, because that type of speed and power and coordination, right, you can't have, that would make someone a king, and it's a threat to the human king. And that's why the magician, one second, the magi in Sanhedrin says that Hormiz, right, they talk about the top, he's Hormiz on top, Hormiz on the bottom. Here's the main lesson, is that the Zoroastrians thought that these forces controlled people. And Chazal tell you, no, people are more powerful than these forces, meaning they're not gods. That's his point. They may exist, but they're not what you think they are. They're not gods, right? They're not powers above people, they're powers below people.
So, essentially, it's a theological thing that all these other, non-Jewish pantheons, they always sound like spiritual.
Yeah, there may be spiritual beings, but they're not powers.
They're not gods.
Exactly. Right? He's in his there. People thought that they were powerful. So what did Chazal have to tell you? No, people can overpower them. Since this is a unique creation, this spiritual being is different from physical beings, etc. He said, they're just part of nature. There are waves in the ocean which are strong, and there are spiritual beings that are fast. Okay. Meaning, they may exist, but they're just part of creation. Don't get too worked up about it. So yeah, the Maharal basically seems to take this literally and say, what this is teaching you is that there may be forces, but big deal. That's his lesson. Right? Okay? I'll be honest, that's better than Rashbam. Meaning, if you want to take it literally, right, the answer is, if you believe in these things, just realize they're just things.
If you want to take it literally, the answer is these things literally exist, and they got killed.
And they can literally be killed by people. Bidyuk. Bidyuk. Right? Bidyuk. So that's essentially, that's one version of what it might look like, take it literally, and actually derive a lesson from it. If you think it's literal, okay. I'm willing to hear that. Yeah. I've got to check whether I'm right about that, but I'm sure that he's thinking Hermes. Right? Meaning he's definitely aware of some sort of Greek mythology, right? Meaning that's like part of the Western canon. It's not like people don't know about it. Right? And he probably, right? I assume Hermes is not that. I assume Hermes is more from the Zoroastrian world, right? But from his world, he probably, it sounds enough like Hermes that I could totally hear that.
So you also
think
you kind of needed.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Your vote is our alarm is off. Very good. Okay. Good. Now the I don't know how you would categorize the Ben Yehoyada. The Ben Yehoyada has a very short comment here, which I'm not sure if he's thinking literally or not. You have to tell me what you think, but it's definitely closer to literal. He says, "Hinei ha-mamar hazeh muchach nitochoshu medaber b'inyan ha-klipot v'kocham." These are talking about the powers of the klipot, right? You know the klipot, right? Like the in Kabbalistic literature, there's the yeah, that right. God's in Lurianic Kabbalah, God's original power entered the world into Adam Kadmon, right? The and it shattered it because it overwhelmed it, right? And that shattered the klipot, right? The vessels into the world, and the world will only reach Mashiach when you find all the klipot and redeem them, right? And return the world. And there's these darkness in these klipot that have to be redeemed. That's like Gloria Anagala. You ever heard about, like, you know, getting rid of the klipot, Tikkun HaKelim, all these things? Like, anyways, what you're doing is you're moving these klipot and elevating them back to basically reassemble. Anyways, I'm messing that up because I'm mixing different parts of it. But the point is, you're finding these, like, spiritual things of evil that have to be elevated in order to perfect the world, okay? So he says, they are these klipot. So I can't explain them to you. I'm not going to say much about it. I can't explain it too much because out of fear. When the klipot will be broken and the evil spirit will pass from the word, and the other gods will be destroyed. And then they'll be understood. So he clearly thinks it's somewhat literal. It's about these forces in the world that you have to overcome. Whatever it means, it means. What? It's Ben Yehoyada.
Oh, sorry.
Ben Yehoyada, the Ben Ishchai.
And then this one is one of those forces?
Yeah, he doesn't explain what it is. He says, I can't explain it too much. Do you?
Right, I just want to get the name right.
Ben Yehoyada, the Ben Ishchai. Okay. Now, not surprisingly, the Mefarshim you would expect to take metaphorical approaches do. So take a wild guess. Who takes metaphorical approach? Who have we been looking at who writes on all these Agadata? The Gra, Rav Kook, right? You know, the ones who write systematically. So let's look at the Gra. The Gra says, Lididi chazili hormiz bar lulita. Inyano shenemar, vivdila prochet lochem in akodesh vin kodesh kadashim, vamru bezoar shuhu chatzera kaved. Shayamnil and Clea call Shu Kodesh Kadesh Mukhala Torah Fila bin Clea Mal Maachal Shem Gamkein Kodesh. Kamamar Hillel etc. So he says, the Gemara that was already mentioned, that the Gemara in Sanhedrin Lamed Tet tells you that the Magi once said that Hormuz is, his half body is Hormin, his bottom half of the body is Hormuz. Right? In the Zoroastrians, they believe that there's this, like, spiritual being that has a dual identity. Now, what does that mean? So for the Gra, what is a dual identity that breaks at the waist? Or breaks in the middle of the body? So he says it's like the parochet. It's mavdil ben hakodesh ben hakodesh kadashim. What in their world there's this idea that human beings half of human beings are holy and half of them are not. The top half of your body, as it were, is devoted to Torah and tefillah, but the bottom half of your body is physical, eating and drinking and sex. But
wait, is it good versus evil, or is it like
physical versus spiritual? And then in the Gemara in Sanhedrin, they responded to the Magosha, and they said that can't be. That's wrong. Right? It can't be that the top is for tefillah and the bottom is for physicality, because you also eat through your mouth. And if you were right that there exists a body in this world which is half spiritual, half physical, right? Top half spiritual, bottom half physical. So then it couldn't be that you would ingest through your mouth. Right? Because that already indicates a mixture between the spiritual and the physical. Okay? Which shows you that even eating and even physicality can be holy. And on the flip side, spirituality can be unholy if someone learns Torah only late by air. Okay? And he says in the Zohar, Lilit is this Sitra Achra or something. Lilit represents these people who only learn Torah for Naaselanu, shame, right? For honor. Okay, so with that in mind, how does he read this? He says as follows. What does it mean that they were running on the walls of Mechoza? So the Gemara tells you in Rosh Hashanah that the people of Mechoza were there, did everything for honor, and therefore they were going to Gehenim. Shvir the Mechoza Gehenim. That the Gemara in Rosh Hashanah tells you that everybody, even the good people in Mechoza, were going to Gehenim, because they were the type of people who even did the right things for the wrong reasons. Everything's about honor. So he says, so what does it mean that this Hormuz figure is chasing, right? Is being chased by the horse rider in Mechoza, on the wall of Mechoza. So it means that in this city, Mechoza.
Yeah,
so now he says, okay, so what is the mashal of the animal chasing Hormuz on the walls of Mechoza? It's the Tamidei Chachamim who are doing it only for kavod. What are they doing? They're chasing Hormuz, because Hormuz is this representative of this. Right, basically, right, the story of Hormuz in the Gemara is of people being able to either, right, it's the Magoshta says the top half is spiritual, bottom half is physical, and the responded, no, right, because food comes in the top, which means it can be integrated, l'tov or l'ra, that you can do good things for bad reasons and bad things for good reasons, or physical things, rather, for good reasons, or spiritual things for bad or materialistic reasons. So you have these Tamidei Chachamim, these in Mechoza, who are chasing Hormuz because they represent that idea that even the spiritual, their only doing for honor. So they're chasing. What? So they're chasing what? So Hermes is the bottom half. Right? Hermes is the bottom half. So they're chasing basically the physical, materialistic aspects of spirituality, right? They're the Talmidei Chachamim who just want to learn Torah for honor, for money, for all the money that there is in Chinuch, right? You know, the fortune in Chinuch, yes. What? Yeah, exactly. But he says they... But he says they will never reach it. Because at the end of the day, the people who learn Torah for the wrong reasons can never quite learn with enough diligence. Right? That's how he reads it. They can't learn with the same shkita. And if you chase it for just honor, you run out of Sitzfleisch at some point. Because you realize you want honor, do it. Find something easier. Yeah, did right?
Since like Torah studies is
right, so what happens? That's how he reads it. So then what happens? Zimna chad v'sargan leitar t'gunayt v'kaimiyatri garza d'dunak. So what is this case of him being by the river and juggling the wine? So he says, ki ayetzer hara v'kol shulcham nikram pidodav tzrisim. Moshem rubi zohar. So he says, kidunaita means someone who doesn't have children. Okay, it's another word for sris, or similar to sris, right? Someone who's castrated, and the Yetzer Hara is considered a sris because he doesn't create anything productive. Okay, so he says, okay, now Hermes represents two different types of the Yetzer Hara. From the top half, he is Taiva and Kavod. And from the bottom half, right, which is like from the eyes and whatever, and the bottom half is the animalistic pleasures. And what does it mean he's juggling? Is he's juggling from Taiva to Kavod, Taiva to Kavod. Right, that basically this representation of the Yetzer Hara, it... Right, whatever works, it balances between pursuits of physical pleasures and fruits of vanity. Why wine? So why two cups of wine? For the two cups of wine that Lot's daughters gave to him, which according to the Zohar are Taiva. It's taiva and the passion. No, yeah, mitorer. It's like. Arousal. You need desire and arousal. So it's two bottle cups of this. Fine. But at the end of days, they will, like the pasuk Yalu Shamayim Yardu Tehomot, the ruach, the nefesh, and the ruach will go up to heaven, but the physicality will go down to Gehenna. So one day God will hear it and he will kill him. So what is the point of this whole thing? Then his summary is recall in yan sipura ma marzel midat taiva va kovo chlav nemar yalu shamayim yardu to moch ozi vidar mitzvah shchavdo to yalu shamayim co va gerit to mom tzlora taiva red chamra yeter vol ozi rakatuf. The whole point of this is to teach you that if people chase taiva and kavod, so they'll start by going up and then will eventually plummet. Yalu shamayim yardu to mot nafsham bira titmo gag. Okay, so how does he read this whole story? Well, I read it last night and I read it again and it still confuses me. But he basically says Hermes represents, is basically the ability to even turn spirituality into being done for the wrong reasons. the Mochoza is the city where people do that. So they chase Hormuz because they want the greatness of Hormuz. They want to be real Talmid Chacham for the wrong reasons. But they'll never catch him because you'll never be a real Talmid Chacham that way. Because you'll run out of motivation. That's the first half of the story. The second half of the story is that the Yetzer Hara is represented by these two taivas which drive people. On the one hand, materialism and pleasure, and the other hand are the spiritual-esque desires of honor and vanity and things like that. And you jump back and forth, because in life, right, what keeps you going is this balance of vanity and physical pleasure, right? And it may look that at the beginning you're going up to heaven, but know that at the end of the day, if that's the path that you will pursue, you'll be destroyed by God. That's how he reads this story. Okay? What? Okay. That's the grub. Very good. Okay. Rav Kook was a little bit easier to understand for me this time. Okay. Fine. Okay, so, but I found Rav Kook here much easier for me to understand how he got it out of this story. Okay, this is what he writes. Bolomar, Mashara Kochara, Bami Chukara Hamunin, Lishum Zav Kislam, Koshgam Enakim, Livnot Bate Choma. He said, this story is about the people who spend their whole life pursuing money, which is represented by the wall, right? They build walls, they build towers, they made palaces, right? That's imagery.
They build tall things.
Yeah, they build tall things, right? They don't want to give anything away, so they build walls, right? To keep their money in. Right? That's the imagery he thinks is this wall. But nothing will keep you safe. Right? They think, right? It's basically the way people who wanted to give Musar, like after you weren't even born, right? But after the Twin Towers, I heard some terrible Musar drasas, right? Of people saying, aha, you see that you built these towers to heaven to make money, right? And like that, they fall. Terrible Musar drasas, right?
So but are we supposed to build towers to heaven to like finish
I don't know. But the point is, right? But the point is, this is a very classic image, right? It's like, you know, Maria Antoinette behind the palace saying, let them eat cake, right? I will stay behind my palace walls, nothing will hurt me, right? And you can starve or eat cake, Mashiach, right? I know she didn't say it. I know she didn't say it. Yes, though when I was going through Homo Deus, guys, when I was going through Homo Deus, he did have one good line about it, right? Where, you know, then that was like the sign of someone who didn't understand, right? They didn't have bread. But he's like, but now it really is cake that kills more than bread, right? So he says, right? Eventually they'll be destroyed because God will destroy them. So with that in mind, he says, okay, now let's work through the actual metaphors in the story. So here's what he says. Hormuz Barlita, Hainu Murshech Ad Mikochote, Lashon Hormuz of Rishut. He said, Havirai Akuf Yudishur de Mechoza, Kimash Mishkanel al Roshea Chomot Agvahot, Hashem Nechoza Tipshim Eri Migdalem Latalpiot. The Sovereign came as B.A. Yoshve Olam Enechim Charu Vekarta. He said, basically, right, the devil, right, the demon, runs on the very things that people glorify themselves in. That's the imagery here, right? That you built yourself palaces. You built the wall to keep yourself safe, right? So you have all your wealth. You don't give it away. You're so great, right? Building on the fact that Mechoza was known as this, right, this arrogant city, right? We're just great. We don't... So he says that the demon runs along the walls. That's exactly what it is, right? You think you built a wall for glory and to keep your money in, the demon runs along the wall, right? That's where he is, right? This is the type of metaphor that modern people, like, talk about. I can hear this metaphor, right? I understood this much more than last week, his anti-Christian polemic thing. This is very different. And he says, you think you're building society by doing that, by keeping all your money in and hoarding your wealth? No, no. You're destroying society, right? The demon runs along. This is the end of your society. That's what keeps God away from you, right? You're so caught up in your money, right? That's not God that you see up there. That's the devil, right? It's not going to help you. He said, what's the horse? When push comes to shove, not only will your walls not help you, but neither will your military strength. Right? The horse. The horse is running along, trying to chase the devil away. Right? Your impending doom. You think you can't solve your doom with money, so you'll try with military strength? The horse will chase the demon? That's not going to work either. Your wall is not going to work, and neither is the horse. What you needed was God, Hashkacha, but you chased him away with your materialism and your greed, and all you're left with is a juggling demon. So that horse is not going to chase it away. He says, but what happens? You chase this demon to the point where your greed becomes your only goal in life. And therefore, he says, how does he read that not a drop falls to the ground? That you become so obsessed with money, even when you don't need it. You don't have kids, you don't have anything, you don't have a family. All you have is money. So you chase this demon, right? You're chasing the demon, and wine, which is the sign of affluence and wealth and happiness, right? You're juggling and not letting a drop fall to the ground, right? Your situation is precarious, right? And pointless, but you don't let a drop of that wine fall to the ground, to the poor people, right? It's Maria Antoinette, right? Nothing will fall to the poor. Let him die. Right? Let him die. And that's the juggling of the wine with not a drop falling, right? This is all you do. All you do is you chase the demon while he juggles, right? Juggles wine in his hand, full glasses. Even though you have so much. Even the day you die, right? Even the day you die, you won't give money away, right? I will take it with me. I'll bury it in my grave, right? I won't bequeath it to my kids or anything, right? Shal yadam. That is hormizbar. He said you are basically the instantiation. You don't realize, but you are the merkava of hormizbar lelita, meaning the demon is riding on you, right? That's what you don't realize.
Shal yadam who mitchazek larbot binyanam and alistor lachrev esher nityashev kidei shigadei halashimon vecheravon.
You're giving him the ability to build, to destroy.
V'yanashim ke'elak shem chugim banim yeshlam ledog l'nafsham. Jelan brach l'mitzad gufam.
When you're, people like this, when they don't have children, let's say, they should worry about themselves, but they don't.
You all come and you'll nafsham akuram yirem shal tzadikim avok jam peirot shema. They don't have good deeds. And they basically, you know, at some point they have nothing. They have no good deeds, they have no family. All they have is money. Right? All they have is power and money. That's all they want. That's all they're chasing.
So what happens?
So he said, once I saw these two kidunaita, which as we saw already is a sris. So he said, I once saw these two srisim, these two people without children. Physical and spiritual, he says, right? You have no, they have no family, they have no mitzvos, they have no value in life but money. And I saw them, and what were they doing? And they were, what are the two sides of the river? This world and the world to come. Right? I saw those same people who had been chasing Hormuz. Eventually, I saw them. Right? They were about to die. They were ready to pass into the next world.
One second.
Yes. So that's fine. And why are they juggling it? Because even as they're about to die, what are they willing to do? All they care about is juggling their wealth. Right? They're literally on the bridge to Olam Haba, and still all they do is juggle their wine. Right? That's all that's their life. And he says, why are they doing it from one hand to the other? Because their excuses for pursuing this money and not giving it to anyone are sometimes because there are two ways that people are greedy. They either don't give their money because they keep it in their bank account because they're stingy, or they spend it lavishly on their wealthy friends, right? Ingratiating themselves, right? Meaning, which in the end are both selfish, right? They juggle the way they do it, but they never give it to tzedakah. They never care about others. And they don't let a penny fall from it, right? To anybody else. And on that day, when you go to heaven, right? Ya'alush shamayim. That's the day that you will discover that this was all for naught, and God will kill him, right? And God, and he says, you could have saved yourself, because tzedakah tatzil mi'mavet. Right? If you had only recognized that what would have saved you was a little bit of generosity, you might have gotten out of it. So the way Rav Kook reads it is very different than Gra. Right? The way that Rav Kook reads it is, even though there are certain commonalities, they both think about taiva, and right? But the way he reads it is basically, there are people who chase the devil because they think that's the good. Right? They don't realize they're on the walls of Mechoza. They're on their walls. Right? They've built their towers for money and power. They think the two things that'll keep them safe are their horses and their walls. Right? Their banks and their army. And they're going to use that to pursue greed, and more greed. And they will sit there even to the day of death, juggling their wealth, right? Alternating between money that they keep for themselves and the money that they use to ingratiate themselves amongst other rich people. But they will never let a drop fall to the earth to the lowly people who they see as below them. But they don't realize that they think that they're on top. But that itself is what leads to their downfall. That's how he reads the story. Okay? Which is... What?
It's a nice read.
It is a nice read. I found it very nice. I thought I found it. It was a lot easier for me to understand than whatever than the Gra on this particular one. Even though there are certain similarities about Taiva and Sris and right. But I thought there of Cook's here. I understood a lot better what he wanted in this story. Yeah. What, that God will eventually kill the Yetzer Hara and, you know, etc. Okay, the last Perush then is the Marsha. So the Marsha quotes the Rashbam, who says that the point of this story is to teach you that God is kind. And he says, Hu dachuk. I don't know what you're talking about. He's like, sure. He said, "Deimkein kol hasipur milta d'lo tzricha leih." If that was the case, the story is pointless. Okay, I know you're all thinking it, but that's what Rashi says. He's like, "D'lo havi leih el d'chazi leih ben abriot." Like, your point is that these demons run around and people see them. Good, great. So, Marsha, like in the back of the Gemara. So he says no. On the Rashbam, he says, this is not a demon running around that God protects you from. That's a stupid story to tell. Okay? He says, no, this is what it is. Hormuz is the Satan, who's the Yetzer Hara, who's the Malach HaMavet. right? And he says, what's this up and down? He said, well, the Yetzer Hara, he, according to Chazal, the Yetzer Hara sometimes is down on earth trying to get us to sin. And sometimes he goes up to heaven to be Makatreg. That's Chazal's image. The Yetzer Hara is also the Satan in Shemayim, who's getting God to punish us for the very things he got us to do. So Hermes is this this representative of the Yetzer Hara. So he says, here's the problem. He says, the greater you are, the bigger Yetzer Hara you are. You have. Right, that's Chazal's read in Sukkah. And therefore he says that we run after him. Even tzaddikim. In fact, the bigger the tzaddik, the more you chase your Yetzer Hara. Because but he says, so where does he run? On the edge of the wall, the Shinei Achuma. Because it's the weakest part. So this is how he reads it. He says, look, he tries to challenge you. He can't challenge the foundations. So what does he do? He just goes in the crown. So what does he do? He gets you to doubt the chukim. Right? He just sort of runs on, like, you know, the chukim. Really? You think this Torah is so smart? What about shatnez? Right? What about... Right? He picks at the little things that are easy to challenge. And he says, the horse here is the tzaddik. Right? Is the tzaddik. And he says, even the tzaddik sometimes... He says, but the horse can't reach him, because Hormuz, right, in the end of the day, will never, I think he might think that the Hormuz is chasing the horse. I'm not sure, right?
That the horse is chasing Hormuz and just never
fully hear it. I'm not sure. I mean, he says that in the end of the day, the Torah does protect the tzaddikim from the challenges of Hormuz. The preda here is for him, the goyim, the non-Jewish nations. The river Dunag is where destruction is coming. The wine that he's juggling is the kosa harila that the Ovdei Chacham will eventually drink, the kosa of punishment. To the two Malchior and Umot, which are... So he reads this eschatologically. He says, in the end of days, Hormuz will be juggling the two great powers at the end of time. The two great nations, according to the vision of Daniel, all the Rishayim. And in the end of the day, right, he spent his life trying to be Mitgareb Bat Tzadikim, right, on the edges, but he never can actually get them, right? And the end, his destruction will come at the end of time as he... Yeah, that's how he reads the story, right? That, yeah, I'm not sure I fully get how all the imagery works there, right? But, yeah, he thinks that it's the Yetzer Hara and the Satan who, right, try to attack the Jews but don't succeed in getting the Talmidei Chachamim because they're only able to, like, at the margins, challenge them, but in the end the Torah protects the Talmidei Chachamim. So instead, what it's left with is that the people who are being punished are not going to be Talmidei Chachamim, they're the... Right, so the evil powers of the world. That's how we reach the story. Sure. Okay, that is the Marashaz. I think on this one I understand the Rav Kook the best of all of them. But okay, that's the juggler and the king story. Oh my God, these stories are difficult. Yeah.